Twilight Sparkle had occasionally dreamed of flying among the stars, surrounded by their light and that wondrous magic that made them so beautiful, and yet so utterly unknowable. Those dreams had usually been fun, with a feeling of being welcome and in complete control of her destiny. Sometimes she'd been warm, sometimes cold, sometimes the stars had been close enough to touch, and sometimes all had been a distant backdrop. She was usually alone in those dreams, and she had certainly never dreamed of being locked in a free-fall wrestling match with another very angry pony. The battle she fought with Arkem was only one of the conflicts she was dealing with as the two tumbled through the strange void. Arkem was obviously trying to kill her, but a part of Twilight didn't want to be left utterly alone. And so, while she fended off his attempts to strangle her or beat her to a pulp, she made no effort to push him away. Besides, the fight helped her keep her mind off the questions she wasn't sure she wanted to answer. Am I going to be in this place forever? Where could I end up going? Will I survive? The star fissure of Sohndar was a shrinking line of light in the distance, something that at least gave Twilight a sense of direction. All that could be seen in every other direction were pinpricks of light in a black void, occasionally obscured by strange, dark clouds. Time started to lose meaning, until another body arrived to interrupt the fight between Twilight and Arkem. Rainbow Dash came diving in, grabbing Twilight in her front legs while lashing out to kick Arkem in the face with her back legs. The maintainer let out a small grunt as the blow knocked him unconscious, and he spun away from Twilight and Rainbow, quickly becoming an indistinct blot in the distance.
"Hey, Twilight! Twilight, you okay?"
Rainbow asked, looking at her friend in concern.
"Oh, Rainbow Dash,"
Twilight exclaimed, hugging her tightly.
"You saved me."
"Not quite yet, I haven't,"
Rainbow said, looking up at the rift of light overhead.
"I still have to get us out of here. Hold on tight."
She positioned herself and Twilight for maximal speed and began flapping as hard as she could to reverse the direction of their velocity. It was slow going, as even from their apparent distance, the wind being sucked into the fissure from Sohndar was blowing against them, and the swath of light never seemed to grow closer.
"Rainbow,"
Twilight said after a moment,
"maybe we shouldn't try to go back. Sondar's already being destroyed because I opened the fissure. What if Star Swirl has already left?"
"I'm not giving up, Twi," Rainbow said through gritted teeth.
"Even if he did leave us here for dead, he can't have taken the book with him. It'll still be there if I can just reach it."
"Oh yeah, that's right,"
Twilight said in a low tone. Several interminable minutes went by, and Rainbow Dash's strength began to flag. The light representing the star fissure didn't seem to grow any closer, and as Twilight and Rainbow watched, it began to fade away, dispersing into faint wisps until, at last, it was gone. Rainbow groaned in weary defeat and let her wings rest. And she and Twilight pulled each other closer for comfort.
"Now what happens?"
the Pegasus asked.
"I don't know," the unicorn replied. "I guess we just keep each other company until..." "Wait, what's that?"
She lit up her horn and cast out a beam of light, which reflected off a book that was slowly tumbling through the void past them.
"Could that be..."
Twilight said incredulously.
"Rainbow!
On it!"
Dash said, turning around and flying towards the book. Once it was close enough for her to get a good look at it, Twilight grabbed it with her magic and reeled it in. The book was bound in a familiar brown cover, embossed with the title Aitran, in solid black ink.
Oh, my Celestia, yes!
Rainbow crowed as Twilight opened up the book with near reverence to the linking panel and held it up for her friend. The Pegasus wasted no time in laying hoof to the panel and vanishing from sight.
Thank you, Star Swirl,
Twilight said as she waited to give Rainbow enough time to move away from the arrival point before linking through herself.
The moment I cast myself into the fissure, I realized the book would not be destroyed as I had originally planned. I often wondered what became of the book over the following Aitran months. Would it continue to tumble through that starry void forever? Or was there something beyond those stars that it would eventually reach? The questions faded from my mind after a while, but it became obvious that the book's story had not yet reached its conclusion.
Starswirl's eyes twinkled as he smiled at his audience in the library of Aitran, particularly at the two mares standing right in front of him.
That book just so happened to be the seventh copy of The Link to Aitran I'd ever written.
Twilight's eyes went wide with surprise. The Aitran book I found in the Royal Archives was the seventh copy,
she exclaimed.
You dropped it into the star fissure, and it ended up in Equestria probably hundreds of years ago.
Star Swirl nodded.
Wait,
Rainbow said.
Are you suggesting that if we kept going through that place, we'd have ended up back home anyway?
Possibly, Star Swirl said.
Knowing what happened to that linking book has led me to theorize that the void beyond the star fissure was actually the space that separates different worlds. Each star might actually be a world, and if you were to reach one, you'd enter it. By chance, the book I dropped into the fissure to trap Aldru and Sohndar reached Equestria, and because of that, Twilight was able to find it. And then you and her came here and resolved my little problem with Cirrus and Archeon.
Well, I for one am glad that everything is finally resolved,
Clover said, but then cast a sad look at the mostly empty bookcase at the back of the room.
But so much has been lost because of those two apprentices of yours, Star. You can always write new books, can't you, Father?
Nix asked.
And Mum has Tay. You do?
Twilight asked, surprised.
After all I went through to save my people, do you really think I just leave them?
Clover said with a slight smile.
I'll have to write a better proper linking book to it when I get the chance, but I made sure to take the original book and its link crystal with me before meeting you at the fissure.
To be honest, Star Swirl said, after all that's happened, I may have lost my enthusiasm for writing.
Everypony gasped or looked at him wide-eyed, and he put up a forestalling hoof.
I haven't made a final decision yet, he said, and if I do stop that work, I'll likely find something equally troublesome to devote my time to. At any rate, Twilight Sparkle and Rainbow Dash, I am deeply in your debt for everything. If there's ever anything else I can do for you, please feel free to ask.
There is one thing, Twilight said. Promise me you won't judge Aldro too quickly. Clover might have managed to get something through to him at the end.
Star Swirl exchanged a glance with his wife, and then looked at Twilight with a grave expression.
Aldro has a long history to answer for, he said, and what you saw of him was but a drop in the bucket. I'll take your request into account, but I don't hold much hope for his changing. Now, the two of you should probably get back home and ease Princess Celestia's worrying.
He nodded towards the Equestrian linking book, which still rested in its alcove on the library's central podium.
Right, we should, Twilight said quickly. Goodbye, Starswirl, Clover, Nix. I'll come and visit again soon.
Catch y'all later,
Rainbow said with a wave of her wing as she followed Twilight to the book. After the pair had finished linking out, Nix turned to her father and asked,
Father, where do you think the Aitran book we used to escape will end up?
Oh, I couldn't even begin to guess, my little star,
Star Swirl said fondly.
The possibilities are infinite.
A few weeks later, in the San Palomino Desert. Out in the vast wilds, far from the nearest pony settlement, and along the ancestral stampede grounds of Chief Thunderhoof's buffalo herd, a small mountain unlike any other in Equestria rose up from the desert floor. Shaped like an irregular cone, its sides were too steep and too smooth for casual climbing. The buffalo considered it a sacred site because some strange sounds would echo out of its hollow top now and then, and in the past some had attempted to decipher them as omens. Nowadays, it was more of an interesting landmark on the Stampede Trail, although the sounds could become unsettling at times. Brayburn listened with rapt attention as his buffalo friend Little Strongheart explained the mountain's history to him while leading him slowly around the base. The majority of the buffalo herd lay in camp a long walk away. They treated the mountain as a landmark to be sure, but normally didn't get too close to it.
"So it makes sounds, does it?" Brayburn asked. "Any pony been brave or stupid enough to try and find out what's making them?"
"Not so far as Chief Thunderhooves has told," Strongheart replied, "and his memory for our history is very long."
"I'll take your word for that, partner," Brayburn said, "and I'm mighty glad y'all agreed to bring me out and show me this stuff."
"You are quite welcome, my friend," the buffalo said.
They continued walking for a moment until they came something quite strange around a curve of the mountain base.
"My stars, what is this?"
Little Strongheart asked, staring at the mangled remains of some strange metal object bigger than she was.
"I don't rightly know," Brayburn said, scratching his head. "This wasn't here the last time y'all came around these parts, I take it?"
"It wasn't. It looks as if it fell out of the sky at some great height. Could it be something a Pegasus team dropped?"
"Doesn't look like anything I've ever seen," Brayburn said. "And I can't think of any reason why a bunch of Pegasus ponies would be lugging a big old metal contraption way out here."
Here's something else,"
Little Strongheart said, reaching into the ruined telescope to drag out a thick-bound book. The cover was brown and made of something neither pony nor buffalo could identify, and looked to be in fairly good shape, apart from a slight dent along one edge. In the fading light of the setting sun, they could still easily make out the embossed, inked title of the book, Aitran. And so ends the story of Sohndar, second of the Aitran trilogy. Join me for the third, and, so far as I've been led to believe, final installment in the series, Naborale, coming whenever C.T. Vulpen finishes writing it. Until then, thank you for listening, and I hope you enjoyed the reading.